Hey everyone, Brian here. Welcome back to EVE Online. So I'm not 100% sure what I plan to do today. I mean, right now, I am on my way to another space station because there's a couple of things that I need to buy in order to outfit a new ship. You guys will remember last time that we were working on a mission chain or quest line or whatever you want to call it for the advanced military career path. Offline, or off camera rather, I did go ahead and I finished most of that, but we're on, or I haven't started yet, but we're going to be starting the last stage. And when I do start the last stage, the quest giver is going to give me a new ship, a catalyst battleship or destroyer or whatever it is it's called. And when they give me that, apparently I'm supposed to use that in order to complete that mission, which means that that ship needs to be fitted out. But I don't have parts that work with that ship, because that ship uses, it has a lot of different modules than I'm used to. Like for my venture, my mining vessel, I'm basically using just 100% mining stuff. I don't even have any weapons on this thing. I carry a couple of drones for self-defense, but other than that, I don't have any way to protect myself in this ship. Whereas the Catalyst is a battleship, and it has 8 slots for weapons, and so I need to get some weapons. And I'm starting to learn a little bit more about how the market works, which is really interesting, because the thing that you have to remember about this game is more than any other MMO that I've ever encountered, EVE Online has a player-driven economy. And you know, we talk about player-driven economies in MMOs all the time. You know, World of Warcraft has a player-driven economy, and you know, any MMO that you talk about has a player-driven economy. There's an auction house or a marketplace or whatever the case may be, where players can take the items that they've gotten and sell them to other players. The thing with most MMOs is that, yes, the player-driven economy exists, but it's not done to this level. As far as I can tell, everything in this game is made by players and sold by players to other players. I have yet to find an actual non-player shop. There are things that you can spend your in-game currency on that are non-player only, like the insurance function for insuring your spaceships. But you know, those things are kind of, you know, just off to the side. They're meant to be money sinks where, you know, some percentage of the money generated in the game is sunk back into the game so that you don't have to deal with too much inflation, because inflation in a virtual market is very difficult to deal with. EVE Online does a really good job with that, though. Anyway, my point is that I've been learning a bit more about how the marketplace works, and because it's a 100% player-driven economy, essentially what ends up happening is you look for the item that you want to get, the item that you want to buy, and it gives you this. And this is a list of every person essentially who is selling that item, how many are available, what they're selling it for, and where it's being sold. Now, if you want to buy something, you actually have to go to where it's being sold. If not to buy it, at least to pick it up. Like, I could go ahead right now and I could place my order and I could buy the 8 guns that I need right now, and that'd be great. Those 8 guns would then be available at that location, but I'd still have to go to that location to pick them up. Now, what I've been learning, and this is something that it actually took me a while to learn, I'm probably just stupid, but, so, like, if I do this, right, this sorts it by how far away it is. So, this one is the closest to me, but it costs a million isk. These ones are at the same place, and they're 49,000 isk, and these ones are 51,000 isk, and all that. Whereas if I sort it this way, and I look for the absolute least expensive of this particular item, only 32,000. So even the cheaper ones that are close to me are more expensive than these ones if I'm just willing to go the little extra distance to get there. So that's what we're doing. We're on our way to Del Toll 3, where we're going to buy 8 of these railguns in order to fit out our new Catalyst warship. I have a list of other items that I want to put on the Catalyst, just for, you know, completing missions and things like that. I don't know if it's a good build or not. Again, you know, the complexities in this game make it so that it's really difficult to identify what is actually a first order optimal strategy. We talked about first order optimal strategies last time, but for anyone who's not aware, first order optimal strategy is just a strategy that has a high power output, it has a reasonably high power output for a relatively low skill input. So, for instance, if you're a brand new player at playing a game and you are just getting into the game, you have a very low skill level. And if the only way to play that game is to use an extremely difficult strategy that only highly skilled players are able to use, you're going to have a bad time playing that game. Because you're going to get in, you're not going to know what to do, you're not going to know how to play, and you're going to ask other players, hey, how do I play the game? And more often than not in MMOs, the answer is going to be something along the lines of get good. You know, get good, don't die. Extremely unhelpful information like that, because the people who are very skilled, it's not that they don't care. And you are going to find people who are willing to help you. Like, I've found a bunch of people, like the alliance that I joined, they're definitely great people, and the person who recruited me into the alliance has definitely helped me a lot in figuring out some of the more intricate systems of the game. But for the most part, the skilled players are more concerned with their own play experience than they are with helping new players reach that same level. So if the game doesn't incorporate first-order optimal strategies, new players and casual players and, you know, people who just aren't very good at it, they're gonna have a bad time. First-order optimal strategies, a great example of a first-order optimal strategy in a multiplayer game is the Noob Tube from Call of Duty 4. And essentially what the Noob Tube is it's just any grenade launcher that's mounted under the barrel of your assault rifle. Now, you will hear experienced players griping about the Noob Tube, but the only reason that they gripe about it is because it allows new players to be competitive at the game. And a skilled player has put in a lot of hours. A skilled player at Call of Duty 4 has put in a lot of hours playing that game and learning the best strategies and earning the best guns and, getting good at the game. So they'll they'll gripe about a new player using the noob tube because it requires very little skill to use. And even new players of the game who use the noob tube are typically able to remain competitive at the game. So as a first order optimal strategy, the noob tube is great. It gives new players the chance to get into the game, have an enjoyable experience, remain competitive, and actually learn how to play the game. Without that first order optimal strategy, the barrier to entry for the game would be too high. That is, a new player would get into the game, and they'd die. And then they'd be like, alright, well, you know what? It's my first time playing the game, I'll give it another shot. So they get back in and they die again. And then again, and again, and again, and again. And they just keep dying, and they don't have a chance to have fun, and they don't have a chance to learn how to play. And then they quit. They just quit, because it's like, why would I keep playing this game that's just no fun for me? And what you're left with at that point is a small group of highly skilled players who are just fighting against each other all the time. Just this small group of highly skilled players who, with no variation, the matches are going to be the same over and over and over and over again. Just the same battles fought every time. Simply because the game didn't design some method for new players to have an enjoyable experience. So it's kind of difficult, and to bring this all back to what we're in the middle of doing, because I know I got a little bit off track there, I am trying to... Oh no, I don't want to place a buy order, I just want to buy. Yeah, that's it. Okay, sorry. To bring this all back to what I was talking about, what we're in the middle of doing in the game right now, is I don't know if the build I'm going to be making on my ship is actually a good one. I don't know that for sure. And the reason I don't know that for sure is because I am still a very new player. But I'm going to be trying my own build here, or at least I did some research and I found, you know, some modules that should work well on the catalyst, because I'm just going to pop in here for a second and load this up. So she's going to give me the catalyst and I can look at the information on the catalyst and I can see what it's like. And if we look at, not the description, the traits. So if we look at the traits, we can see what it has, right? And we can see here that it gives bonus to small hybrid turrets. It gives a bonus to their tracking speed, and it gives a bonus to their fall off. So how far away you can be before the damage starts to fall off. So what we're just gonna fit it with a bunch of small hybrid turrets, like the railguns that I just picked up. And I've also got some things on my list here for an afterburner and a capacitor recharger, armor repair unit, you know, just some things that are gonna help help make it better. And allow me to, you know, hopefully do a good job and hopefully survive some of these later missions that I'm going to be working on. But the reason that I talk about this stuff a lot, you know, these game design concepts, probably not everyone is going to be that interested. I'm going to be honest, because this kind of thing isn't for everyone, you know? Not everyone is interested in game design concepts the way that I am. Some people are probably just gonna wanna see the gameplay, and things like that. But for me, my channel on YouTube, I want it to evolve. I don't want to just be doing gameplay. I want to be able to use my channel as a platform to talk about subjects that interest me while I play games, and in the context of games, and how those topics that I'm interested in relate to games. And one of the things that I'd really like to do is, you know, focus on games that have interesting game design elements, and then have a chance to talk about them. So, anyone who's following my channel will be familiar with my, I have a new Minecraft series out, and in that Minecraft series, I've actually started talking about some game design concepts, and that's all that Minecraft series is. Whereas in this game, I am still kind of talking about what I'm doing and why I'm doing it, and, you know, kind of trying to explain a little bit about the game for people who maybe haven't played it before. With the Minecraft series, I'm not going to spend a lot of time doing that. I'm going to spend the majority of my time on the Minecraft series just talking about game design concepts, and I'll do my best to tie those concepts back to Minecraft and you know, talk about how they relate, just so that it has context. But the point of that series is not to give a walkthrough for Minecraft or give a guide for Minecraft, because I'm going to be the first to admit I'm not the best Minecraft player, any more than I'm the best Eve player. And I'm, you know, if you guys want, like, a walkthrough or a tutorial on Minecraft, or even on Eve Online, there are probably better ones available than my videos. But what you will get from my videos that you may not get from other videos is an analysis of the game design elements, the things that a developer must have been thinking about when they designed the game. And, you know, with EVE Online, that's really difficult because the game's been around for so long and it's evolved so much that a lot of what was originally in the game probably isn't in the game anymore. And if it is in the game, it's probably completely unrecognizable. So I'm trying to focus on aspects of the game like first order optimal strategies, which again allow new players to get into the game without having to worry about being competitive. Something else that I wanted to talk about really quickly, hopefully really quickly, because I know I have a tendency to go on and on and on about different things, but in my recent Minecraft episode, what I discussed was a little bit about the difference between cheating and hacking in games, at least from my own definitions of those terms. For anyone who hasn't seen my Minecraft series, I'll recap it real quick here, but I'm not going to go into the same level of depth. If you're interested, go check out the Minecraft video. Probably link to it at the end of this video so that you can get there easily, or you can just go to my channel page. So for the purposes of my definition, hacking is when you somehow modify the game's code so that the game behaves in a way other than what the developer intended. So whether that's removing health limitations, removing ammo limitations, giving yourself items that you would otherwise have to find in the game, things like that. Anything that modifies the game code in such a way that it behaves in a way it wasn't supposed to, that's hacking. Cheating is kind of the same thing, but it's built into the game. Rather than being some kind of third-party program, you going out and modifying the game so that it functions differently, cheats are built into the game. And, you know, it's for whatever reason, the developer has chosen, either intentionally or unintentionally, to leave those cheats in the game. I mean, how many single-player games out there have a god mode function that you can access if you know the right codes? How many games out there allow you to remove your ammo limitations or give yourself any item in the game that you want just by entering the right codes? Games with console commands, games with creative modes, games with debug modes. These are examples of cheating in games where the developer has either accidentally left those functions in the games and players have discovered them, or the developer has intentionally left it in the game. And that brings up an interesting point, right? Again, the full discussion of that's in my Minecraft video, but if you have to ask yourself, why would a developer intentionally choose to leave cheats in the game? Doesn't that destroy the vision of what they wanted that game to be? And, you know, the answer is kind of interesting. Yes, it does change the vision of what they were trying to create, but at the same time, what it's really doing is it gives the player the opportunity to enjoy the game the way that player wants to enjoy it, because everyone has a different style of play. Now, before I get too far into repeating myself, the reason I'm bringing this up now is because there is a related topic that is very important, and that is hacking in multiplayer games. There's no defense for that. None whatsoever. In a single player game, you can defend cheating and hacking, because if you are playing a single player game that you have legitimately purchased, it could be said that you have the right to experience that game the way that you want to. But when you start talking about multiplayer games, there's so much more to consider. The first thing that you have to consider, we won't get into the free-to-play side yet. For now, the first thing to consider is the other players. We talked briefly about first-order optimal strategies and how, if you don't have a first-order optimal strategy in your game, new players are probably going to quit because they're never going to have a good time. And that's 100% true. Now throw cheaters into the mix. Now throw people into the mix who are hacking the game so that they have unlimited health. Right? Now even the skilled players can't compete. And they're going to start quitting. And they're going to start quitting because they're going to just say, this game is full of cheaters. I've put in all of this time to get really good at this game, and now there's all these cheaters here and the developers aren't doing anything about it. How can I enjoy the game? So by cheating in the game, by developers not very quickly dealing with cheating in the game, you're creating an environment where no one is going to want to play. The only people left will be cheaters, and maybe they'll have the fun for a while, you know, just running around not being able to kill each other until someone figures out how to do an anti-hack or whatever the case may be, but it's still a bad time. So you can't defend cheating in multiplayer games. The other problem, and this one is much, much more important, is hacking in a free-to-play game. Because now we're not just dealing with multiplayer. Now we're not just dealing with other players in the game who want to have a good time and can't because you're cheating. Now we're talking about a company who is providing you and other people with a product that they are able to access for free. This company is still a for-profit organization. The creators of EVE Online, CCP, they are still a for-profit organization, and in order to continue to operate EVE Online, they've got to worry about their bottom line. They've still got to make money. And the way that EVE Online chooses to make money, like every developer of a free-to-play game has their own monetization strategy. And I'm not going to get into that right now, because that is... that one's a whole other kettle of fish. That one is, you know, talking about, you know, a lot of the predatory methods that free-to-play games often use in order to monetize their platform. I don't really want to get into that right now. Maybe in the future, if anyone's interested in hearing me rant about free-to-play games, leave a comment down below. I will happily do that in a future episode. But let's assume that the game doesn't use any predatory methods at all, and the monetization is handled perfectly and efficiently. The game offers some kind of premium service for an extra price. EVE Online, for instance, offers their Plex. The premium, what is it? The Pilot's License Extension is what it's called. So EVE Online offers their Plex. You pay a certain amount per month, you get your Plex, and it gives you what amounts to a subscription for 30 days. And that subscription expands a number of different options. It gives you more ships that you're able to pilot. It allows you to increase your skills beyond a certain level. The way that EVE Online handles it is essentially what's known as a paywall. But in EVE Online it works because you do have the opportunity to buy Plex with in-game currency. So that's good. But so the developer offers this premium service for an extra cost. If you somehow found a way to hack the game to get that premium service for free, skill training completed. Wow, that's just a whole different situation. Because now, I mean, that's actual theft. That is stealing. It's fraud. It goes way beyond just impacting other players. Now, what you've done is you've actually taken away the company's opportunity to make money off the game. And companies like these have massive costs because they have to keep a team of developers on hand to continue developing new content for the game. Otherwise, the game doesn't stay relevant, and it just stagnates. So they need a team of developers on hand to continue developing content. And they need programmers on hand to continue fixing bugs as bugs are found. And they need moderators online, and they need, you know, they need to pay server costs, and they need to... There's all kinds of different costs that a company like CCP incurs in the life cycle of running a game like EVE Online, which is really just a massive, massive game. Hang on, just gonna take a sip of my drink here. My voice is starting to get a little bit hoarse. I don't know if you guys can hear that. But, yeah. what you're doing in that case is you're actually stealing, right? Because you can assign an actual real-world dollar value to every Plex. If, I mean, obviously the in-game cost of Plex, we looked at that last time, it's around 1.2 billion ISK right now. And apparently it fluctuates based on the market at any given time. So, but those Plex, which are in-game items, they have a real-world value. Each Plex, purchased individually, costs about $20. So, if you find a way to hack this game to give yourself Plex without paying for it, you have literally just stolen $20 from the developer. Bottom line, nothing more. Like, that's what you've just done. And this presents a whole host of different problems, because, again, now players who can't pay for the game, or would rather just enjoy the free functions of the game, they're going to have an even worse time because of people who are, cheating the game to get stuff for free. It's like, well, you know, I could do that, but I'd really rather not because I don't like that idea, the idea of stealing from the developer. And then you've got the people who are actually willing to pay the little extra to get the premium features who are just like, well, why would I waste my time or my money if other people are just gonna, you know, break the rules and try and get it for free? Everyone loses in that situation. But eventually, the losers are going to be the cheaters themselves. Because, yeah, while good on you, cheaters, you got your Plex and you didn't have to pay for it. Good on you. But eventually, the people who actually do pay for the game are gonna quit. And CCP doesn't make any money and eventually has to shut down the game. And then where are you? You've wasted your time hacking the game. There's no point. It doesn't make any sense. So, this has gotten really long-winded. I really have to apologize to people, but when I get on topics that are really, you know, interesting to me, I do have a tendency to go on. And if you have a problem with that, just leave me a comment below. Obviously, you know, try to be as nice about it as possible, but, just telling me, damn it, Brian, shut up, is also fine. I hear that all the time. But, just don't do it. There's no defense for that. There's no reason to do it. If you can't enjoy a game without the game's premium features, but you're also not willing to pay those premium features, find a different game. You know? Bottom line, there's nobody wins through hacking. And that's all I'm gonna say about that for now. We're just wandering around right now, finding and picking up the different things that I need. That is not what I need. What is it that I need? Sorry, I made a list while I was offline because the last thing that I wanted to do in the episode was, you know, flounder around trying to The last thing that I wanted to do was flounder around trying to figure out what I wanted to do while playing the game. What do I need? Oh, okay. I need a damage control. But yeah, no one... No, this isn't that much more expensive than these ones, so there's really no reason to make the jumps. It's like, yeah, great, I'll save 93 ISK. Big whoop, I'll just buy it here. I gotta be very careful, though, because I'm running out of, Yeah, I'm running out of space. I guess I can leave these behind. I don't really need these items, and I can always come back for them later if I find that I really do need them. Oh yeah, but look, I can't actually hold it all. Okay, so I'm gonna have to come back for the damage control unit too. All right. I need to go back to my main hangar, which is 5 jumps away. So we'll go back to the main hangar, and we'll drop this stuff off. And maybe I'll see if some of the stuff that I need is already back at my main hangar. Because I mentioned last time, I have so many items, I still haven't figured out what to do with, nearly any of the items that I have in my hangar. Okay. Yeah, I have no idea what I'm supposed to do with some of the items. Like, I know that some of them are materials themselves. Wow, that's a big ship! That's a big ship! Look at that! Look at that ship! That's a big ship! What kind of ship is that? Holy crap! That's a freighter. Yeah, that's a bowhead freighter. How much storage space does that have? Holy crap, that thing's got 4,000 cubic meters of storage. That's like 2,000% bigger than my venture. Approaching stargate. That's crazy. Of course, my venture does have an ore hold that holds, you know, 5,000 cubic meters of raw materials when I go mining. So that's cool. But yeah, I have some of the items that I have back in my hangar. I know that some of them are raw materials themselves, which are used for like manufacturing and crafting things and stuff. And then I know that some of them are, or some of them get broken down into raw materials, which you then use to manufacture and craft different things. But I haven't sat down and taken a close enough look at manufacturing yet. Maybe we'll do that another time for the rest of this episode. Like, I want to get the catalyst built. And I'd really like to both get the catalyst built and go out and do this last mission for the advanced military path. I'm hoping that I have enough time to do that. I'm trying to get through this as quickly as possible. That's one thing that you have to keep in mind about EVE Online. It requires patience. You cannot, and I'm actually wasting time here because I haven't selected a new skill to learn. But I don't even know what skill I should learn. I'm gonna be piloting a Galente destroyer, so I'll tell you what, I'll learn the next level of Galente Destroyer, because that'll make me a little bit better at piloting it. Yeah, what I'd really like to do, I'd like to be able to fit out the new Catalyst Destroyer and go out and do the last mission in this advanced military pathway. And hopefully I'll have the chance to do that, you know, within the time limits that I set for myself. And you know, those time limits really are, like, they're an artificial construct. Like, there's nothing that prevents me from going a little long or making the episodes a little shorter. I'm experimenting. I'm trying to... The channel is evolving, you know? YouTube is an ever-changing thing. And I don't know if what I'm doing is working, except through you guys. So... if there's something you want to see, if you want me to change something that I'm doing, if you want something different, or you want something new, or, you know, you want to see more of the same thing, leave a comment down below. I do my best to answer every single comment that I get. And, you know, I've gotten some comments that are basically spam. People asking for, you know, people for asking for subscribers for their own channel. It's like, hey, if you sub to me, I'll sub to you. It's like, that's dumb. That doesn't benefit anyone. Because if I'm not interested in your content, even if I sub to you, I'm probably not going to watch your videos, which is all YouTube cares about. And if you're not actually interested in my content, are you actually going to watch my videos just by subbing to me? I highly doubt that. I don't know. It's a dumb thing. It's weird. You know, the whole idea of sub for sub. I mean, I guess maybe having more subs makes your channel look better, but, you know, I'd rather have the 21 subs that I have right now and have all of those people actively watch my channel than have, you know, 100 subs who are only there because I subbed to them and who are never going to watch a single episode that I put out. You know, I don't know. I don't know if I'm wrong or they're wrong or whatever the case may be, but my understanding of how YouTube works tells me that useless subs like that aren't going to give me any benefit. For those of you who are subscribers to my channel, thank you so much. I'm not trying to say I don't want more subscribers. What I'm saying is that I want people to subscribe for the right reasons. I want you to subscribe because you enjoy my content. I want you to subscribe because you think there's some value in the content that I'm creating. And I want to create, you know, sort of an interactive experience. Leave the comments down below. Ask me questions. Give me suggestions. I'll do my best to answer and, you know, get to every question and suggestion that I get. To this point, there aren't really any questions or suggestions, so I can't really do that. But if someone were to come out and say, hey Brian, can you talk about this game design concept? I will happily do that. Even if it means I have to go out and research that particular game concept because I don't know it off the top of my head. I will happily go out and do that just so that I can answer that question. And if you want to see me play a specific game, or do something specific in a specific game I'm already playing, again, just leave a comment and I'll do it. Because that's what I want. I want that, you know, kind of interactivity for my channel. I don't want people coming to my channel to feel like it's just me sitting here talking to you or talking at you for 15 minutes to an hour. I don't know if I'm ever going to do, you know, content that's longer than an hour until I get to the point where I'm able to start streaming things And I do. I do want to start streaming. That's another direction I want to take this. And I'm sorry that this has devolved from game talk to YouTube talk, but one of the things that I really want to do in the future is I want to be able to stream. And I want to be able to stream things like EVE Online so that, you know, I can have that interactive experience where I play EVE Online for, like, you know, 6 to 12 hours at a stretch and have people who are watching the stream playing with me. Things like that are really cool. That kind of thing really interests me. But, oh, what's this? Oh, that's my wallet. Is anyone... What about chat? Yeah, no one's talking to me. Okay. But yeah, I mean, that's the kind of direction. That's the kind of direction that I want to take my channel. And that doesn't happen... that doesn't happen without you guys. Without, you know, some kind of interactivity, I don't know what people want to see. The problem is, of course, that in order to stream, like, anyone who's followed my channel for a while and watched some of these, watched some of my videos, this is all going to be, you know, old information for you. But for anyone who hasn't, anyone who maybe this is your first chance or... I haven't talked about it in any of the individual videos that you have watched. I'm doing YouTube, I'm doing these gameplay videos on an extremely limited budget. The laptop that I use to record PC games is 9 years old. Almost 10. Like, this laptop is going to be... I think this laptop is going to be 10 years old this coming summer. And that's, like, the fact that it plays and records games like EVE Online and Minecraft and, you know, new games like that. Or not new, but, like, you know, quality games like that. The fact that it plays them at all is just a testament to the fact that when I bought this computer 10 years ago, it was... a top-of-the-line gaming computer, like state-of-the-art gaming laptop. But it's starting to feel its years, and, you know, that's evidenced by the fact that when I play these games, I have to have graphic settings tuned way down. And I had to turn off the, you know, I had to turn off all of the particle effects, which is why at the end of the last episode of EVE, we didn't get our really cool, you know, massive explosion, which sucks because I'm sure that that would have been really cool to look at. You know, I run into the same problem when I want to start streaming. My CPU just isn't powerful enough to handle running the game and streaming it simultaneously, because something that I've discovered when I've tried to do a couple of small test streams is that streaming uses up way more power than recording. So while with some settings tweaks I can get the games to play and record at the same time, I can't really get the games to play and stream at the same time, which is unfortunate, but I am working on it. And if you guys enjoy my content and you want to support me creating my content, I do have a Patreon page. Links in the description down below, up in the top right-hand corner at the end of the video, all that good stuff. Feel free to check it out. If you can't donate yourself, share the page with everyone you know. Maybe one of them will be able to help. You know, things like that. Just sharing it is just as important as the individual donations themselves. Because the more people we get this in front of, the bigger it can become. And the better opportunity I'll have to create the high quality content that you guys deserve. Now, what was I doing? Sorry, I didn't mean to get sidetracked there. But I really do want to take... I really do want to take my channel in that direction. Like, that's where I want it to be. You know, I want it to be high quality, diverse content with a lot of interaction from you guys. And if you guys want to support me in getting there, check out my Patreon, and we'll do this together. Now, what else am I missing? Right, the power core. Yeesh, that one's expensive. Where is it cheapest? Oh, I was already there. Okay, you know what? I know. It's more expensive. Holy crap, is it the most expensive? Jesus. All right, whatever. I'll just spend it because I'm really starting to, you know, get close to. All right, I think that's it. I think I have everything I need. Let's double check. But yeah, I have a lot of stuff. Like, I have a lot of stuff. Okay, cap recharger, check. Damage control, check. Oh yeah, there it is. Small enough, yeah, the armor repair, micro auxiliary power core, afterburner. Where'd the guns? Oh, they're there. Okay, yeah, perfect. So I've got all my parts. Which means I can take this mission. Perfect! Alrighty then, let's see. The exam. Here is a mission suited for someone of your caliber. We're going to be stepping back on this one and letting you take control of the situation. One of our patrols spotted a small group of suspicious vessels heading towards a local pleasure hub. After processing their ship's ID tags, we've determined that one of the pilots is known terrorist responsible for dozens of station bombings. A Concorde raid into the premises would be picked up by the terrorists well before the ships actually arrived. We need this murderer taken out while we have his location, so you must move in yourself and then assassinate him. Cool. Alright. Kill the terrorist leader inside the hub. Cool. Alrighty. Okay, let's accept this mission. And she'll give us the catalyst, and then we'll get that set up. Hangar. Ship's hangar. Catalyst. There we go. All right, let's see this ship. Oh, that's cool, actually. I kind of like it. I mean, this game has, like, it's so cool because every ship has, like, a slightly different design. And you can get different skins for them so that they look different. But, I mean, that's just really neat, isn't it? Okay. Let's fit this out. So, it needs this armor repair unit and this auxiliary power core and this capacitor recharger and this damage control. And then all eight of these guns. And, like, I honestly don't know. Like I've said, I honestly don't know if this is even a good fitting for this ship. I don't know. Like, on my other ships, I use these 150mm Gauss cannons, which maybe they're better. Maybe the ones I've got now are better. I just don't know. You know, if anyone has good build ideas for me for future ships, please feel free to, you know, leave a comment, and I'll try different builds out. For now, I'm really just going off the information that I was able to find on my own. I think that's it, right? Let's double check the fitting. Yeah, okay, I got 8 guns, and all the other slots are filled. And, yeah, okay, so if you look up here, I've learned a little bit more about this. Like, this is how long my capacitor is sustainable if I'm using everything simultaneously. Right? Like, if you look here, this is how much of my power grid is being used right now. Okay? So, I am under the 100%. If I'm just sitting in space or traveling through space, my capacitor is fine. If I start using everything simultaneously, on the other hand, that'll create a problem. So I've got to be careful. Once I engage in combat and start using all of my stuff simultaneously, then I'm gonna have a problem. Okay. So let's undock and head out into space. I'm gonna go do this mission. And that'll be it for this episode. But, yeah, you know, I have a lot of ideas. I'm sorry if all of that sounded like an ad for my Patreon account. Like, I don't want to seem like I'm begging, you know? I'm not. If people don't feel like there's enough value in my content to justify supporting my creating it, that's their decision. That's up to them. But if you think my content has enough value for that, please feel free to become a patron. You know, it doesn't have to be a lot, and you'll get access to, you know, all kinds of cool. I've got a behind the scenes series planned where I'm gonna, you know, start talking about different things that I'm gonna be doing for my channel. I'm going to start releasing patron-only content. I mean, obviously not right now, because I don't really have any patrons yet. But I want to assure people that all of the content that I'm putting out that is currently free will remain free. Like, I'm not trying to say that this is going to a pay-to-watch sort of format. I would never do that. That's just dumb. It, you know, that's no better than dedicated pay-to-win games, which we will talk about at a future date, because there's a lot that games that monetize could do better. What? Oh, right. There we go. We're gonna take care of this mission. But yeah, if you've got the time, just check out the Patreon page. You know, share it with your friends. Get people looking at it. Get people talking about it. Scanners are picking up 3 hostiles. Looks like they've noticed you. Good luck. Oh, crap. Oh, my goodness. Okay, we're gonna have to come back. I am a huge moron. Oh my god, I can't believe I just did that. I do not have any ammo for my weapons. Okay. That would have been bad. That would have been really bad.
Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
I got distracted and nearly went into combat without any ammo. How much ammo do each of these guns hold? How much? Volume, capacity, reload time, activation cost, rate of fire, optimal range, damage modifier, hybrid charge. Yeah, charge size small, but how many charges does it use? I honestly don't know. So, we'll just... how much space? 450 meters. Even that's bigger than my freaking... Alright. Let's see. I'm gonna grab... Let's grab 3,000. 3,000 rounds of antimatter charge. That's probably too much, but it's probably way more than I need. All right, round two. Warp to location. Okay. Now we're... Oh my god, I didn't load any of them. I should have loaded all of these guns before. There. Okay. Let's just get the terrorist leader, because I'm... Target. Yep, he's using some kind of like stasis or dissipation or something, but I don't think it matters. I think he's dead. Yeah, he's dead. He did. And how about you? You gonna be dead too? Boom. Ba-da-da-doo. Alright, and he's dead too. And that's that. I don't know if that's the best way to do that. Like, I've tried looking at, you know, some of this stuff. I don't know. Oh, maybe I can... Maybe grouping them all together is the right way to go. Not sure. Well, let's go see what he's got. Let's go see what he's got in his inventory. Pick up that cargo. Yeah, I don't know if that's the best way to use all of those items. But, I mean, look, obviously... Obviously, that was... a short enough battle that I didn't end up using up my entire power supply, so... cool. And then we'll just be heading right back to the same... I'll just be heading right back to the same dock that I was at before, so we're all good. But yeah, I mean, really, seriously, just to take it back a step here for a second, if you enjoy my content, please subscribe to my channel. That'll keep you up to date on what's going on with my channel, and, you know, it gives me the opportunity to keep making content for you guys. Maybe check out some of my other videos. You know, I don't know what kind of stuff everyone's interested in. And leave a comment if there's anything that you'd like to see on the channel. Questions you might have for me to answer, it doesn't have to be regarding game design. Game design is just one subject that I'm interested in. If you want to hear me talk about something else, I'm interested in tons of different subjects. If you happen to ask about a subject that I'm not interested in, I'll still do my best to talk about it. I'll go out and I'll research a little bit and figure out, you know, what I think about a certain topic, and I will talk about it in an episode.
Docking permission requested.
That's a promise.
Docking request accepted.
But for now, I really want to thank everyone for watching, and as always, I'll see you again next time. Bye!